Hello, my name is Ella.
I'm Chloe.
And my favorite color is brown. Just thought I'd share that. So we are going to share our screen so you can see what we're up to. Oh my gosh.
Oh, sure. All right, there we go.
I'll just keep getting out. Okay, here we are. And we are presenting our project on contemporary art, and ours is basically all feminist art. So we're pretty excited. Oh my God.
Here we go. All right, here's our first piece.
So just take a second to look at it. Really think about what's happening in this piece.
Interesting looking piece. You know, there's like a lot here that I think is very out of the norm. It's just shocking to look at, really.
I totally agree. And I didn't know what to think when I first saw this. It's very chaotic. I'm like, there are very different colors happening here. And clearly there's a story that we don't know yet.
So what is this story about?
So this story is a classic retelling of Judith killing Holofernes to save her country. And we've seen this in many other pieces. So for an example, we've seen Artemisia and her Judith slaying Holofernes, kind of showing that agency that these two women have. And then we also have Caravaggio's Judith beheading Holofernes.
And I can really see a huge difference between these two pieces, because in these traditional Judith beheadings, you really see a lot of action happening, and this is a much more still looking piece to me.
Yeah, and just to highlight that, I feel like, you know, in Renaissance, it was always like, this captures a moment, this captures a story. And for this one, I feel like it's capturing the woman. Like, she is the subject. It's not about the story, it's about her being amazing and being victorious. So going back to kind of like the form of this piece, it obviously has a lot of bright colors, but it also contrasts with the light. Like, there's the bright shining on the fabric, but then there's also like the brown of the dirt and the shadows within the fabric.
And so, you can also really see a lot of textural contrast, just like the smoothness of her what she's wearing, mm-hmm. countered with like the background and the dirt. It's really just a lot of contrast happening.
But we love that. So the function, I said this a little bit earlier, I mean, it's telling the story of Judith, but I feel like it's also just highlighting this amazing like woman in history. To me, that's what it means. Mm-hmm. But it's also all about recreating like all of these old art pieces to kind of honor it, I think, but also just reinvent it in a way. And I think that's what this artist is really all about, because she does this with many other people in history. Do you want to talk about the content a little bit? There's a lot written down there.
Yeah, sure. Okay, so in this piece, I think one of the first things that you notice is when you look at her face, you can really see how little emotion she has. She looks very serious. She's looking straight at you. She doesn't look scared at all, I feel like. I think she's really just, she's just there. She looks like a very powerful woman. And I think, again, that kind of adds to our this whole feminist approach and the woman approach. Anything you want to add, Elle?
Yeah, so there are just like distinct details in here that stand out a lot. Like, obviously her clothes are very Renaissance. It reminds me of Giovanni Arnolfini and his bride, where she was kind of holding her dress as well. But like, if you look closely, the thing that makes it look like a picture is kind of like the tackiness she put into it. Not to be weird, but like, mm-hmm. her makeup is just so intense and very non-Renaissance. Like the drawn on brows, the like smaller lips, the eyeshadow, it's just very kind of like artificial. And same goes for the guy, because that's a mask, you know, it's just like a Halloween mask she had from somewhere. Do you want to say anything about the mask and the face? Or maybe something else you noticed?
You know, another thing that really stands out to me in this piece that I just find very interesting, and I'm not really sure about the content behind it or the context behind it, But I think one of the things that really pops out to me here is her feet. They're just, they're not dainty. They're, she has, she's got some big feet, you know?
Yeah, she's putting it out there, yeah. You know, and we respect that.
Yeah.
But, you know, I feel like all of that feels so cartoonish. Like the her face, the guy's face. And then, to me, the realest thing in this picture is her holding the dagger. Like, that looks like a photograph. And the rest of it kind of feels like an oil painting.
Yeah.
So the form is just, there's a lot happening.
There really is.
Do you want to say anything about the context, Chloe? A little bit?
Yeah, sure. So
we have it written down. It's good. It's good.
Sorry.
It's a lot of reading. I'll start it.
Okay.
I'll start it. So what's fascinating about this is that the artist did this all by herself. So this is a photograph she took. She did all of the designing. She did all of the hairdressing, the makeup, the costume. But she created it to look like a Renaissance oil painting. And that is insane how she's able to make it look like a painting when it's just her chilling out. You know, and I think that's the great thing about this piece is that it looks like kind of an illusion. Like from far away, it looks like an oil painting. You're like, how did she paint the light perspectives and the detail in the drapes? But then up close, you're like, it's kind of unpleasant. It's like, it's kind of cheap fabric. It's weird makeup. It's a Halloween mask, you know? So it's just not what you'd expect. I think it's all about reinvention and just
wait, so is the person, correct me if I'm wrong, but is the person who, like, the actual woman who's being portrayed in this, is that like the artist herself?
That is the artist herself.
Oh,
and so she did that in a lot of other portraits, kind of just saying, you know, and people were like, is this supposed to be you as the character? And she was like, no, this is the character. It's not about me. It's about these historical women. And what's one word you would use to describe this piece, Chloe?
I would say shocking.
I would say unsettling. You know, it catches you off guard. You don't know how to describe it.
That's very true.
I'm also going to show this really quick just to highlight the things you were talking about earlier. There's the artificial makeup. There's the kind of weird looking mask. There's the realness of the hand and like the blood on the knife. That's just amazing.
And you can really see that detail, and especially I think the fabrics behind her, they just look so real to me.
Yeah.
Like, wow.
It's amazing. And, you know, and also there's a small Renaissance piece where, like, she looks kind of pregnant, you know, it's kind of coming out, the fabric kind of extends, and that also reminds me of the Giovanni, Jan Van Eyck piece, where she also looks pregnant, but it's just her dress, and that's just saying, like, it's kind of femininity in a way.
Yeah.
But I think we're gonna move on from this piece. But,
All right.
I like it. I like
Me
it.
Too. I like it. All right, so this is our second piece that we're gonna be talking about today. It's called Lying with the Wolf. As you can see, we have a nude woman who is lying with a wolf. There's not much more to it. But we do have a lot of context behind this piece. So this piece was made by Kiki Smith, and this is one of the works that she made in a collection between 2000 and 2002. She made several other pieces that are also, all of the pieces are some kind of nude woman depicted around nature, and surrounded by animals. And these depictions kind of just show a relationship with nature, and there's just a lot of background going on there. So Ella, do you have anything that strikes you about this?
One of my first thoughts is it reminds me of the Untitled 228 we just looked at, because it's just about this relationship between the woman and the wolf. It's not the background. It's not people in the background. It's just her and that connection.
And I'm glad you said that, because actually, part of the content of this piece is the artist really wants you to focus on that relationship, and that is just her entire goal here. So she made that that specific goal to not include any background or anything. So kind of diving more into the background of this piece, when Kiki Smith created this piece, she was actually creating a narrative with two other pieces, Red Riding Hood and Saint Genevieve. So basically, most people know the narratives between these two pieces, but the way that she is taking these two pieces and kind of combining them, it kind of just shows that feminist aspect, because she's creating this whole new narrative. And as you know, in Red Riding Hood, that's a very not very feminist story whatsoever. It's really just like a little girl who's very defenseless. But in this piece, instead, she's taking this wolf and she's turning it from this predator-prey relationship, and she's turning it more into this just a human and basically a domesticated animal just lying together. And that really says a lot about femininity, because she's creating an equality here where there previously was not one.
Wow, that really hit me in that last one. The equality there compared to like the old stories. She is reinventing it, and I think that's what's great. To be honest, when I first saw this piece, it was also one that it unsettled me. But I was also intrigued. I was like, why is it so unsettling? Is it?
I would definitely agree with that.
She's nude, kind of like the way it's drawn. It's not supposed to be super like beautiful.
She's really, yeah. And I think whenever you see a lot of nude depictions of women in art, there's a lot of sensuality into it. And you really don't see that here. You just see a nude woman depicted, which I think is kind of refreshing, honestly.
Yeah. Yeah, there's something about it. I've always liked wolves, part of why I think we chose this one, but it's just powerful. Like, how'd she tame that wolf? I like it.
I like it too.
I like it. And if we could compare these two pieces, what do you think we would say about the two of them?
I would definitely say there's a lot of empowerment happening here.
Yeah. I think it's that empowerment and that female agency, as well as reinvention. Like, these women are taking old narratives and putting it in a new light, in a new feminist perspective. You know, this woman has more equality, and alongside with the Judith piece we just looked at, she killed the guy. It's all about her being victorious. So is there a piece we could connect these two that we've learned? One that I thought of was the Giovanni Arnolfini for Untitled 228, but I also thought of another one. I can't think of it in the moment, but it was cool.
Yeah, so.
Thank you.
All right. I believe you.
So there you go. There's a lot to know about these, a lot of the context.
Very interesting pieces.
We've enjoyed this project a lot. It's been fun.
I like what we've seen.
Yeah, we will see you later, and I'll see you later, Chloe.
Okay.
Amen.
It was so funny.
I just think it's so funny. Oh my god. Okay, so.
Oh my.